Ladies and gentlemen, please rise for our national anthem. Please welcome 2011 NACE Chairman Ron Nagy and 2011 CARS Chairman Mitch Schneider.
Makes you want to dance, doesn't it?
Yes, it does. Welcome to Orlando. For those that don't know me, my name is Ron Nagy from Nagy's Collision Centers. And this is exciting. This is an exciting time. We are here in Orlando. I think the attendees, the vendors, they spoke. They wanted a change in the venue, and I think ASA listened. We did that, and the exciting part is, I think you responded by showing up. You know, NACE holds a very, it's actually very special to me. I think it is instrumental in the growth that my brother and I had in growing our shop, the six locations. It's the one place we could come, we could look at equipment, we could talk to the vendors, one-on-one, not interrupted by the phone, by the emails, by the text, by every other form of interruptions, and we could talk to them one-on-one. It's a place where we could come, take classes on management classes, continue to learn, continue to grow as owners. But I have to say the most important thing to us was also the networking. It was the one place we could come meet people just like you that were in the same position we were, wanting to learn the same things, but we traded stories and we learned how to grow our business. And I really, really feel it was instrumental in helping us grow, not just in size, location, but stronger owners, growing as owners. I would like to take this time actually right now to even recognize all the past chairmen. So if you're a past chairman of NACE, if you would, please stand up.
Not all at once.
And I have to say it was a great honor being named chairman, to be listed among some of the past chairman's names. It is a great honor. And it's a great honor to be standing beside this guy. I was sharing with him how old I was when I first started reading his articles, and I thought he was going to pass out.
Made but me Mitch, feel really good.
Tell us what CARS, I think, means to you.
You know, it's fairly interesting. The first time I ever left the shop to speak anywhere was at ETI in 1984. Soon thereafter, I was asked to deliver that same message at CARS in New Orleans. I think it's kind of really cool that next year is our 30th anniversary, and it's going to be in New Orleans again, so you know for sure I'm going to be there. But I can say without any doubt whatsoever that had I not gone to that first CARS to speak and then taken advantage of everything that was there, I wouldn't be here today. I went home from that meeting after seeing Dick Vinay. I don't know how many people here remember Dick and one of his presentations, and my father thought that I'd lost my mind because I walked into the shop that morning and I raised the labor rate by 20%, $6 an hour. He was absolutely sure we were going to go out of business. I didn't care. I thought it would be, you know, if I could fix a car, I could probably become a plumber and do something else. So I can say without equivocation that had I not come and learned and grown and been exposed to other ideas and recognized that there's a greater world that existed outside Schneider's Automotive Repair, I wouldn't be standing here before you today talking, because we would have gone out of business long ago. But we're preaching to the choir. What I need all of you to do is go home and tell somebody that you know in the industry that you trust what a great time you had here and what you learned and how it's helped you and how you've grown. So, and then drag them with you to New Orleans next year so we can double the size of the show. I don't think that's an unrealistic goal. So I can't tell you what a privilege it's been for the last 2 years to work with ASA staff and ASRW people and get this to happen. It's changed my life in a lot of really wonderful, positive ways, and I can't thank everybody here enough. And serving as your chairman has been incredible, and I'd like to recognize all of the CARS past chairmen that are here today. So if you would, please stand up and be recognized for the contribution that you've made. And with that, I think I'd like to introduce our president, Ron Pyle.
Yeah, it's truly a pleasure to work with people like Mitch and Ron. Our industry is populated by a lot of really fine individuals that bring so much to the table when they attend an event like this. The networking is a critical part of what we offer. We've heard loudly and clearly from you, the independent repair professional, that you want this venue to be as relevant as possible to what you do every day. And we've tried to deliver, and we will continue to deliver based on what you tell us is important. It's an awesome responsibility. We were doing the math. We think there's roughly 100 individuals that play some pivotal role in the production of this event. And that's not counting the folks that are here in Orlando that we don't meet with on a regular basis. They're just part of this facility's efforts. So all in all, I can't even imagine how many people have to really contribute to this effort. But I know that it's worthwhile, and I know that the proof is in the pudding. 29 years of success says that we're doing the right thing. And we will continue to do the right thing by listening carefully and adjusting as necessary. One of the things we think is important is to recognize tradition. We honor tradition. We honor history. We believe that it's important. Our association is 60 years old. It's important to think about what was happening 60 years ago in the automotive industry, and then relating it to what's happening today and understanding that without change, we would not have survived, we would not be here today. So honoring that tradition is important. But recognizing that change is inevitable and that we do have to make adjustments in our models to remain relevant, we will do that as well. Changing our venue, going back to honor tradition on the one hand by returning to our roots and rotating the show locations, allowing more people to be exposed to this experience, was a good move. You asked for it and we delivered it. On the other hand, there are new elements of our event that are in direct response to the fact that the industry is changing and will continue to change, and we have to adjust accordingly because you are the industry. You are the constituents we serve. And it really doesn't matter if you're a member of our association, although we want everyone to be. We're going to serve anyone in this industry with this event because we think it's an obligation of our association. We believe it's something that we've been entrusted to do, and we're going to continue to do it as well as we possibly can. I'm really pleased today that we're going to also recognize a lot of individuals in our industry. That's one of the things that tradition has allowed us to do, is talk about the folks that have brought a lot to the table over the years with their sacrifice and their contributions to our association, to the industry at large, and just as humanitarians, just doing the right thing in their own local markets, in their own local neighborhoods. Serving is what this association is all about, and serving is what many of you do locally that makes me proud to be associated with all of you. So over the next few days, there will be individual recognitions. There are folks that are going to be receiving rewards later today. And I'm going to put a slide up on the screen so that you can get some idea of how many awards will be delivered here while we're in Orlando. The ASRW Industry Awards include awards like our association awards that our individual association provides. And then there are AMI awards. The Automotive Management Institute provides a number of different awards and scholarships. There are the trade press that serves our industry also delivers a number of different awards and recognizes outstanding achievement from a number of industry professionals. All of that will take place over the next few days. And everybody that comes to this event and is recognized for their contribution should be proud of that. And each of you should be proud that you are associated with professionals like this. So we use this venue to recognize individual achievement. And we thank everyone who will be at the award ceremonies later today. And then we have a special introduction that I would like to make for a prestigious award that we offer at this time each year. And to do that presentation, I'd like to welcome Scott Schreiber to the stage. The Body Shop Business of the Year Award is a competitive award.
Good morning, Ron.
Thank you, Scott.
Thank you, Ron.
Welcome, Scott.
Good morning, everyone. Isn't it great to be here in Orlando? Those of us East Coast people, it's great to be here. Being from Akron, Ohio, it's just nice to see that big orange ball. I'm not sure exactly what maybe some of you can clue me in on exactly what that thing is. But thank you, Ron. Thank you for the ASA moving it here. Thank you for having this great venue, and thank you so much in your organization for allowing us to be a part of this great gathering of the industry. It remains my honor this year in 2011 to present to you today the 2011 Body Shop Magazine Executive of the Year Award. This award has been given out since 1984 to true collision visionaries, people who have exceeded and experimented and experienced great success by being forward-thinking, overcoming challenges, and persevering in the industry. The career of this year's winner began in 1976 when his high school consumer electronics teacher offered him a job at his father's auto body supply shop. He then enrolled at Thaddeus Stevens School of Technology and worked in a small body shop to hone his skills in the trade. In 1980, he joined a multi-franchise dealership, and he served for 13 years as a technician and a body shop manager. Then in 1993, he met Don Keenan. Shortly thereafter, they together opened the first expansion shop of Keenan Auto Body in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. In 2001, he was promoted to partner and assumed the role as vice president and chief operating officer. He currently operates 11 locations at an annual sales of over $19 million annually. Beyond growing Keenan Auto Body's bottom line this year's winner, his staff and their family who are here today to support him have contributed to their community by hosting an annual golf outing. They raise over $200,000 and give it to the Big Brothers and Big Sisters Camp, Make a Dream, Children Youth Services, Make a Wish, and the Philadelphia Ronald McDonald House. He's also spearheaded green initiatives within the Keenan organization, He converted the entire organization over to low VOC waterborne paints. He installed solar panels when it wasn't fashionable to install solar panels, I might add, and is constantly looking and researching for ways to make their shops and minimize their impact on our environment. He's also deeply involved in the industry outside the shop. He serves on numerous VOTEC advisory committees, and he is a member of the NABC, the CIC, and the ASA. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you the 2011 Body Shop Business Magazine Executive of the Year, Mike Lavasser. Mike.
What I appreciate about that is the natural humility, you know. That's just, that's typical of our industry. You guys don't recognize necessarily how important you are in your local communities. And that's a shining example of that. This time it's really my pleasure to welcome one of our, I don't even know the right word to use, most treasured assets and partners in the industry, our sponsor of this particular general session and of our keynote address. DuPont has been a terrific partner through the years. One of the most gratifying experiences I had shortly after joining ASA was to hear from some representatives of DuPont that they would like to come to our headquarters and sit down with us and talk about the future of this event. They wanted to know our intentions, they wanted to know how they could leverage their presence and be a long-time contributor to this event. And we had a very frank discussion that day. There were a room full of individuals with strong opinions about what this event needed to be. And we listened, and then they listened to us. And we forged what I believe is one of the strongest partnerships in the collision repair industry. It's been a long-term relationship, and we thoroughly appreciate it. And that's why that logo is on that wall. This time it's really a pleasure to welcome my friend, Harry Hall, to make a presentation and introduction of our keynote speaker. Welcome, Harry Hall.
Ryan, I appreciate those comments. I remember that occasion. We had a lot of fun. I think we accomplished some good things. So once again, I'm honored to be here in Orlando on behalf of the DuPont Company to help kick this thing off. NACE 2011. Orlando, we're not in Vegas, a little bit different. You can change things up a little bit. Nice venue, don't you think, guys? Scott, big orange ball. That's once again, you know, DuPont Performance Coatings, we're really proud to be here exhibiting, delivering some really great education seminars, and sponsoring this opening session that I know you're really going to enjoy. According to Merriam-Webster, innovation means the introduction of something new, a new idea, a new method, a new device. Innovation has been a hallmark of the DuPont Company for more than 200 years. We innovate every day, creating sustainable solutions essential to a better, safer, healthier life for people everywhere. Take Tyvek Home Wrap, for example. We've been insulating homes for over 30 years. And our DuPont Kevlar, it's used to make vests that protect our law enforcement officers as well as military personnel all over the world. And believe it or not, DuPont invented the first sprayable automotive finish. It's evolved into today's most innovative waterborne base coats, that are used by collision repairers all over the world. You know this base coats by the names of Chromex Pro, Permahide Hi-Tech, and Stando Blue. Well, up until recently, it was these types of technological innovations that were changing the way that business was done. But now, with the advent of social media, we have even more new and different ways of promoting ourselves, our services, and our products, and connecting with our customers as well. And that brings us to today's keynote speaker. He is an author, a journalist, a marketing consultant, and a frequent speaker about social media marketing who educates businesses and other organizations on how social software can enhance their strategies. He is the president and CEO of Human Business Works, an education and community company. He consults and speaks professionally with Fortune 100 and 500 companies like General Motors, PepsiCo, Microsoft, and Google, discussing the future of business communications and social software technologies. He's a New York Times best-selling co-author of Trust Agents, and he's a featured columnist at Entrepreneur Magazine. I know you're going to enjoy his informative, engaging presentation, as well as his energy. Had a chance to meet him earlier, and a lot of energy in this guy. And you're going to leave here armed with new ideas and real possibilities for using social media to grow your business. So please join me in giving a rousing NACE welcome to Chris Brogan.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Sawu bona. It's a Zulu word. It means I see you. I like starting my speeches with that because it's really different than hi. You know what hi means? Like this part of hi? This means I have no weapon. I intend to do you no harm. I will not stab you. Kind of hoping that's table stakes for us getting to know each other, don't you? But sawu bona means I see you, which means I recognize that there's somebody there. And the response is nighona, which is I am here. I think that's kind of a cool way to do it. First off, a little bit of housekeeping. For everyone who's way in the back and all that, I bathed. I smell amazing. Should you want to get a little closer, I'll talk quieter. It'll be like a secret club. And we won't tell the people who come in late what we're talking about. Is that fair? Is that all right? So I stayed over at the Peabody Hotel, which is awkward for me because I stayed at the Peabody in Memphis. And as I'm checking in, I kind of made reference to that, sort of in that snide way that people do when they realize they're in the copy, not the original. It's kind of like an aftermarket part for a hotel. I just learned that inside stuff, and those of you who make those parts, I don't even know what I'm saying. But evidently, you can't really get paint onto those aftermarket bumpers as well. It just doesn't stick. That's what I learned. I'll be at the DuPont booth. We can argue this one later. I don't even know what I'm saying. But I want to talk to you about this. So first off, I get to that hotel, and I'm like, you know, I have to say something, and I'm not a big fan of bragging because it never works to my advantage. I said to this nice lady at the front, I said, I was an honorary duck master at the Peabody in Memphis. Now, you all know the gig, you know, people who didn't stay, who stayed at the Comfort Inn last night or something. So the Peabody has this hotel, and they have this fountain. And the way old story was that these fellas snuck in a bunch of ducks and got them into the fountain one morning to be funny after a night of beverages and healthy beverages. And so since then, the Peabody trains ducks every single year to come in up and down this elevator and get in the fountain and swim around, and people take a gazillion pictures, and there's a big crowd of people there, and like, whoo, duck, right? And you, the duck master, there's a real guy who's the duck master, like the trained animal professional, and then there's idiots like me who they bestow this honor to, myself, Oprah Winfrey, Larry King, you know, weirdos, and they give you a cane with a duck on it, just in case you're not sure what you're supposed to do. And you just kind of walk along with some ducks. And you get in the elevator with them, and you go up, and you're like, it's you, a guy, and a bunch of ducks in an elevator. If you're at all freaked out by birds, this is your worst nightmare. And if you're not, it's still a little awkward. OK? because, you know, you smell a little something, you're wondering if it's the duck master or the ducks. I'm not making this up. So I mentioned this to them last night, and they say, wow, we had no idea. You know, and like, I felt like, ha-ha. And they said, well, have we got a special room for you? So I get to my room. Man, those ducks snore. Uncomfortable night. By the way, there's like little duck-shaped soap in the bathroom. That's awkward. I'm rubbing a duck all over my body right now. That is very, like, I thought, you know, staying at a Westin where you rub leaves on your body was weird. That's just the trials and tribulations of people who travel. What I loved about everybody before me, because I'm clearly an idiot, what I loved about everybody who spoke before me was that they spoke about things about passion and pride and relationships and listening. The words I heard from everybody before me are the things I'm into. And so first off, please keep making noise. You don't have to laugh. I'm not always that funny. But make noise. Please use your phones. Please text, tweet, Facebook, something. If you don't even have any of those services, just pretend. Just touch your phone a lot, and it'll make me feel like I'm amongst my people. There's people that I've known in this industry for a few years now that I don't even know what they look like. I've only seen the top of their head. A lot of balding people. All I'm thinking is advertising space. That's all I see when I see that. DuPont clearly must make a paint that sticks to heads. And I'm thinking we could get that done. It's like the little red posse over there, I noticed. For those of you watching me on the monitor, I look exactly the same in real life, except I'm here. For those of you watching this later, I'm so sorry. But we led with passion. We led with listening. So just before I came on stage, I kind of got a little, you know, teased about it. I was using my phone, and I asked Twitter people, you know, hey, what would you want to tell the auto body world and the repair world and all that? What would you want to tell the people who fix your car? And I got a few hundred answers back. Because I'll tell you what these devices are. They're opinion givers. Dana M. Nelson says, auto people, just because I'm a woman does not mean I don't understand car talk. Please treat me with respect. I would like to offer the counter. Just because I'm a man doesn't mean I have a clue what you're saying to me. I know what a vacuum solenoid is, evidently. I'm going to talk so much about my Camaro during this speech. I bought a 2010 Camaro, and one of the things I'll tell you is that I knew that people would come up to me and ask me stats that I have never known about any car I've ever owned before. My prior five cars were Saturns, which means I didn't actually even need your industry, because people would smash into me and the car would just go doing, and it'd be fine. I'm kind of not even kidding. Like, you know, I would just like, hey, look at this. And you kick the car, and people were like, what'd you do that for? And I said, because who cares? I only did that once with my Camaro. You know, and what I love about your industry, too, is it's a total industry that you fall into. I hear all you younger folk, like, accidentally go to school for this now. But everyone else, you just, like, you know, evidently had a thing for suction cupping out dents. You know, that's like, just you're pretty good at it. Like, I don't know who decides that they're the person who wants to buff out a scratch. But, you know, bless you, because, boy, if I got a lot of scratches on my car. We're going to have to talk afterwards, by the way. I need some of that armored hide paint. It's not just about repairing a car, but ensuring the safety, comfort, and mobility of the occupants. Make sure you actually call me back when you say you're going to. The more you educate the customer, the more that the customer will have trust in you. By the way, the number one word I saw over and over and over again in people's little tweets, honest. Be honest. If it's bad news, tell me bad news. That's the number one word. If you just write one little note down on any one of your note cards, just write the word honest and bring that back and say, that's what several hundred weirdos that I've never met said. Be honest. What else do I have to tell you? Oh, so last week I was up in Toronto, which happens, and I was speaking to all of General Motors car dealerships from Canada, sorry, so 450 dealerships. And one of the things I told them is that where they could get some of the most trust and response and loyalty and friendship back is in service departments. and working with the parts departments and getting some of those relationships going. That cars aren't the thing they're selling, that they're selling the relationship after the car. Now, you all know that. That's built in. But it's kind of weird that I'm here a week later. Like, I don't pick these things. It's not like there's some menu in my room, like, for breakfast, and I'm like, I'd like to go talk to the paint people, and the dent and scratch people. And by the way, the car dealership people hated me because I was like, you've got to get on this Facebook and this Twitter and all this stuff I'm talking about. And they're like, you know, we're busy. We just want to sell cars. I said, I know. It's so weird how that telephone thing came into usage 100 years ago. And you had to start answering it. Oh, now there's that internet thing. Wow, you know, you're small business owners, you're independent business owners. 1/3 of your time is spent prospecting, if you're doing it right. 1/3 of your time is spent doing really good execution of operations, and 1/3 is supporting and servicing the customers you were lucky and blessed and honored to have as your customer. Am I wrong at that? Does anyone else do it a different way, like 1/8 of the time is prospecting? Oh, that's right, you're not here because you're unemployed. How's that Walmart greeter job working? Holy cow. None of you in this room are Walmart greeters because you all have all your teeth. I didn't make it up. I go to Walmart. I buy stuff there all the time. I buy Batman underpants there. Not joking. My job, in case you're wondering what it is not stand-up, although I love stand-up. My job is to really help you understand how to amplify the online channel, how you amplify being human and doing that stuff that you know how to do in person online. That's what I'm really paid to do. I help big companies, little tiny companies, just solo companies, figure out, why do I have to get into this? What do I need to know? And God, it seems so annoying, doesn't it? Like, the words are stupid. Twitter. Who makes you say that word out loud as a grown adult? Do you tweet on the Twitter? That is not a conversation you want to have with another grown human being. Blog is a horrible word. You get told that you should be all over YouTube, and yet when you go there, there's dogs on skateboards. It's actually kind of good video, really. But that is what I'm paid to do. And I have two real goals out of this event. Really what I want to do is I want to do two things. One of them is for you, one of them is for me. I think that's fair, right? We can trade. My goal for you is I want you to come away with one or two ideas that you think you can implement that are worth like $2,000 to $5,000. Because that way I've kind of at least covered your airfare and your hotel and your beer tab for tonight. That's the $5,000 people. The $2,000 is the people who are getting to bed early. We're going to see the mouse. The goal for me is that I do my job well enough that you actually stay vertical and awake and that coffee keeps working and that you clap a lot at the end as if I was as important as Mike who like gave $200,000 to charity. That's my plan. It's like I'm going to get that level of applause having given only a few $1,000 to charity, not $200,000. Those are my goals. Who here is in the part business, by the way? Anybody? Okay, a couple. Who here hates raising your hand? Who didn't bathe like I did, so maybe doesn't want to raise your hand and give that a secret away. See, because I don't think anybody in this room is in the parts business. I think you're in the restoration of trust business. I think you're in the restoration of order business. And in my case, the restoration of beauty business. So I have to talk to you, like I said, about people whining about having to get into new technology. Sometimes we just don't want to accept the reality we have. Last year, I bought a 2010 Chevy Camaro SS. This is the first nice car I've ever owned in my life. And to me, this is the most amazing car in the universe. It is the Batmobile, and I drive it accordingly, which means into a cave underneath Gotham City. It's really awkward, because the real Batman's there, and he's like, what are you doing? That's my spot. I love this car. I slide this conversation into absolutely unimportant places like McDonald's. You know, out there in the parking lot, that's my 2010 Chevy Camaro SS. They're like, really, would you like sauce with your burritos? 426 horsepower, did I mention that? That crap will kill a Mustang GT. And they're like, yeah, that's great, sir. Here's your change. Do you want to give a dollar to the Ronald McDonald House? No, I can't even catch up with Mike at this point. I might as well not. But the reality of my car is this. So I'm from New England. Perhaps you've heard of it. I live in the northeastern part of Massachusetts, right on the New Hampshire border, which is why I know at Walmart people have no teeth. Seabrook, New Hampshire, my friends. Home of a nuclear power plant, several tattoo parlors, fireworks stores, and a Walmart full of people who evidently aren't like your Walmart people, who look like fashion models, clearly. That's called a callback. Which is different than a recall. I might want to explain for those of you who are from this area or from the southern hemisphere that in New England and Massachusetts most especially, we get this snow thing every year, all the time guaranteed, and partly cloudy is what you shovel. And so I have a really nice car, and the very first indication I have of this being really nice is that when I get it in July of last year, the guy I had to take it to for detailing, which is something I've never done in my life, never have I gone to, in fact, my idea of a car wash is it rained, looks better, but I paid for detailing because a long story that we won't go into. There's like real points to this, but we'll get there. He says, so where are you going to garage it this winter? And I looked at him and I made this face kind of like, garage? But because I'm male, I said, well, of course I'm going to garage it. Because there's no way a guy is ever going to admit that he has no idea what the other guy is saying. So I'm like, well, yeah, well, I haven't really checked. I mean, I have a few options open. Where do you garage your cars? And he, you know, clearly makes the face like, I know you know nothing of what you're speaking. And I felt like, well, it's a day ending in Y. It must be me. And so I ended up not garaging it. And so it ended up underneath a snowbank of about 10 to 15 feet of height. And I'm absolutely not making that part up. I have video of me shoveling my car out. It was like the movie Alive when the plane crashes in the mountains and they have to eat people. That part was a little hard to make real because people kept running away from me while I was trying to eat them. But the shoveling out my car part was really depressing. So as I'm shoveling out my car, let's just think about this. So it's 15 feet under snow. I find my hood with the metal edge of my shovel. Oh, I love this room. This is like car people horror stories. That was so cool. Like, I've told that story a million times, have never heard that collective. And frankly, I'm a little troubled by that because you all should have been like, well, that's about $500 I could get out of that. More than that, right? Because I got to tell you the first thing I learned when I did that sound, besides the first thing that all males, most especially, but all humans do, that didn't happen. I didn't really do that. Probably just hit some ice. And of course I did. My car looks like a dyslexic person tried to key it. It's very awkward. Why did someone write Quijibo on the roof of your car? On the hood, sorry. I don't even understand which part's which. Camaros are very low, so it all feels like a roof. So then I go and I talk to somebody who has nothing to do with the car business, because that would... Why would you go to a body shop? You just ask another male. And he said, well, you know, you can't just get the hood replaced, or because your car's going to be two different colors. And I was like, what? And so I learned of this thing called the sun. And evidently it changes the color of the car and that your car isn't really the same color as when you buy it. All these things I had no idea are true. This is a very long story to tell you that the reality of the fact that I own this fancy pants car took a long time to catch up to me. So then I garaged it from like March to June when winter was about over in Massachusetts. And now I take it out. And so this year, of course, I'm going to be a little more sane and I'll garage it starting in winter, which is next week. And I'll buy one of those awesome like $400 cars you see everywhere, because I think that'll be kind of funny. And by funny, I mean really sad. By the way, it turns out 426 horsepower in the snow, absolutely nothing. Absolutely nothing. My car idles in 15 miles an hour. So I'd get out to try to push my car, and it's just sitting there going, ah, I'm going somewhere, I'm not going anywhere. And it's a manual, so that's even weirder. Because then I'm like going to show up on a YouTube video, because I'm pushing my car by myself, and it's, you know, engaged. So should it go somewhere, then I've already lost the game. That's almost the last thing I'm going to talk to you about my car. I want you to think a little bigger in our little conversation time today. Think about this as being guest experience design. Your business is guest experience design. If you look at that, what does that mean differently to you? I'm going to talk about two major things. One is guest experience design, and the other is CRAP, which is actually an acronym. You guys are evidently huge on 3- and 4-letter acronyms in this business. I'm meeting people who are ASAs for the AAM and the something or other, and ASWR, which I kept spelling ASRW. See, I did it again. I keep saying it wrong. And then, by the way, if you Google search for the wrong one, you find interesting things. Nothing dirty. So I'm going to talk about guest experience design and CRAP. When I say guest experience design, I mean you've all started to implement this. We were having a talk, Mike and I were having a talk earlier, that the waiting room is a little different than it used to be 10 years ago. Wouldn't we all agree? It is not just a greasy linoleum tile floor and channel 8 and coffee that you made at 6:30 when you came in. You know, that waiting room has suddenly become really important, hasn't it? It's been a piece of real estate that matters to people's service perception, which I find interesting. Wi-Fi in the waiting rooms, anybody get that in their facility? Look at that. See, it is the future. You know, you can get Wi-Fi at McDonald's and all that too. And I think that it's amazing that this is suddenly this amenity that you must provide to be the right kind of waiting room. But what have we learned, right? This is the same thing we learned by putting video on the back of the car seat on your SUV with your kids. Originally, you think you're putting that thing in there because when you take that long trip, they're going to get to watch The Lion King for the 77th time. And what you really end up doing is you put that thing on for a 5-minute drive. You're going to the grocery store. They're in there. SpongeBob! Right? It's the same thing with Wi-Fi. You put Wi-Fi on, everyone shuts up. You know, they're not sitting there going, I don't have time for this, because next thing you know, they're playing Angry Birds. And they're totally content. They're in the waiting room. You know what I love about that is like the 36 people in this room that actually play Angry Birds knew what that meant. And then that scares me more because it means when the spaceships come down and get us, they're going to think that's how we communicate. You know, that story you were telling me about shutting people up and all that. You know, we all have smartphones for the most part, and those of you who don't are here under duress and you're just here for the jokes and the coffee, I guess. But, you know, those of us who have smartphones, we're used to doing this to things now, aren't we? And have you found yourself doing that to things that don't do this? Like, you know, the thermostat in your bedroom now? How many people touch their laptop because they bought an iPad, so now they're doing that thing where they're like, oh, dude, I'm not, you touch this one, but you don't touch that one. It's great when they do it to plasma screens. I have a 9-year-old and a 5-year-old. There's amazing. I don't even know. I think they say, I think I need jelly to use this to work better. And then rub on the plasma screen. So then later I'm watching a movie of mine or something. Like, I don't know, Batman Begins. And Joker has that like weird reddish stuff all over his face. But it turns out everyone does. That's neither here nor there. You know, I was thinking though, why not put an iPad in the waiting room? Why not give these people an iPad to play with while they're there? What's that, $500 now? It's getting less and less. You can get one of those new Amazon Kindle Fires for $200, put a bunch of books on it and some movies and crap like that. And people are not going to walk out with them. You've got their car. You know what I mean? Who took the Kindle Fire? They're not getting back that Beamer. I'm going to go with you got some leverage on not losing the device. Now, are they going to break one every now and again? Sure they are. But man, wouldn't that be cool? I think it'd be pretty cool, especially if you could do stuff with them, especially if you could have them on Twitter or something, watching updates. Wouldn't that just freak your service guy out? Fixing the damn car still. Part doesn't quite fit. Please don't give us that level of detail. You know what? Airplane pilots don't tweet. So I come from the computer software world from before. I was in telecom and wireless telecom. Engineering types, oh my gosh, if they flew planes, we would all have heart attacks every single flight. Engineers are this. We're going to die. Oh my God, we're going to. Oh, that's just a red light. It's fine. You know, and I like how, you know, we get more and more desensitized. I've got a service light on in my car right now, and it's a false warning. Evidently, there's some pins in my tires that tell me what my tire pressure are. And I also have something like that when I, you know, take out that pen that you get that actually tells you what tire pressure is, and the pen's lying. So, yeah, I know there's a bunch of people who just got to shiver, like, oh, my God, don't listen to the pen. You know, when the tire shoots off the back of my car, I'm going to be those people who are right at cars. But I got, like, an exclamation point on my dashboard now. I like that they replaced the service engine thing with an exclamation point, because evidently we respond to those more. I love that kind of stuff. Guest experience design. What does that mean? So what is the guest experience? You know, what is their moment of truth? What are they going to go through when they're involved with you? These tools that I'm going to talk about, like social media. See, I've barely mentioned any of that social media baloney yet, and you all thought that's what we're talking about? Secret, that is what we're talking about. This is that. The guest experience starts long before they show up, because you need people to actually know you're out there. And so if you're still taking out ads in the local paper, you know, I'm not knocking advertising. Please advertise with people. But your local paper circulation is going down. If you're buying radio spots, well, that kind of makes sense because you're in the dash. If you're buying local TV, there's this thing that God invented evidently called TiVo, and people don't see the ads anymore, right? I learned this from somebody. Do you remember when that show Heroes was popular, when all the superheroes were popular? So I got to interview one of the stars, which, by the way, my entire life is made up of strange events like this that I have no control over. Someone will call me and say, hey, want to interview the star of somebody from Heroes? Okay. And next thing you know, I'm talking to some fancy lady from Hollywood. And I said to her, well, it must be really cool that the show's getting more popular, because that must mean that you get more money and more stuff happens. And she goes, actually, it's really weird. It's backwards. As the show gets more popular, more people put it on their TiVo, which means that they see less ads, which means advertisers pay us less money as the show gets more popular. I said, well, no, that's weird. Maybe that explains why TV sucks. Because you got to keep it at the certain suck level to, you know, get good ad money. Right? It's like a fuel mix. That's what I'm figuring out. It's like a fuel mix. People aren't seeing the ads as much anymore, and they don't want ads, right? I mean, no one in the audience is like, you know what would be great right now? A great advertisement. I'll just stop and tell you a little bit about DuPont coatings. They're very important for your car. They're, you know, you can get powder, you can get anything you want. Nobody wants that. But when you need the something and you get the opportunity, we love to shop for something new, don't we? My gosh, you know, the new iPad 4S, the iPhone 4S came out, and in my world, that was like, it's a new thing, because it's white now. You know, who cares? It's a telephone. It does the same thing the other one did, but now I guess you could talk to it. Which, you know, if we are all nerds in the room and we watch Star Trek 4, that didn't work well for Scotty. That's such a weird inside joke, but, you know, they go back in time to the 80s, and he picks up a mouse, and he's going, hello, computer, and it has no idea what he's doing. That was my grandparents with computers up until they died. They're just forever just baffled by the mouse. Steve Jobs, rest in peace. He passed away yesterday. We don't have to have a memoriam. It's your technology industry, not mine. So did Fred Shuttlesworth, a famous civil rights activist. But what Steve Jobs did is gave us all a bunch of tools that let us connect to all our peeps. You know, it allows us to do something that do you remember before iPhone? Because even if you don't have one in this room, before iPhone, everyone said the same thing. What's your plan like? How many minutes do you get on your plan? That was the only thing we could talk about with cell phones. Now everyone does that show and tell with applications, like we're 9 and we're trading cards again, right? You got the new Mustang one? Yeah, I got the new Mustang one. And next thing you know, they're talking about their apps, right? That's new. Making your phone what you want it to be. I was at Consumer Electronics Show in January, and I was looking at that new Hyundai where you stick your Android phone into the dash, and then all the crap that's on your Android phone goes all running through the car. It's a little different than Ford's model with the Microsoft whatchamahoos it. But same kind of premise. You take your phone out of your pocket, and you bring your life to your car, and your car kind of gets to know all your preferences and all that. Holy cats, like, you don't have to fix enough things as it is. You know, now suddenly you're going to be having arguments. You know how you have those arguments? It's a manufacturer, it's you, it's, you know, all that. And you're going to be doing this with phone companies. Isn't that going to be funny? But it's out there. Like, we can't fight these things. These genies don't go back in the bottle. When it comes to thinking of guest experience, you're thinking ahead of them instead of advertising to them. You're thinking of what we called in trust agents, be there before the sale. When I say that, You want people to think of you before they've had their accident. You want them to think of you before they need your service, as just sort of in the back of their head. You want to be top of mind in the back of the head. It's a really weird spot. It's about right where people start going bald first, I think. And the way to do that is just really engage on your communities. Now, this is where you have all shown aptitude already in different ways in the physical space, right? You do community events. You do show up at all the fundraisers. You do go to the chamber meetings and all those kinds of things. You guys chamber members for the most part, chamber of commerce types? Man, those meetings are boring, aren't they? Oh my gosh, what a that's like, I was going to say something that would get me in trouble in certain sectors. But I will say that going to a chamber meeting is a little bit like having to go to town office to, for a planning meeting or a zoning board meeting or something like that. Except that you get those business card ninjas. Man, that's my favorite part of Chamber of Commerce. You that person comes up to you and they got their little throwing stars in their hand and they're like, hey, how you doing? Right in your belly. And they haven't even met you yet and they're shaking your hand and they're looking over your shoulder while they're shaking your hand and giving out the business cards like this. And all you're thinking is, I don't even know who you are. There's a business card sticking out of my belly and I don't even know what you're trying to do. And they're always for something stupid that you don't need, like gutter repair. I mean, just how many times did your gutters fall off in 1 year? Once a year. They make shoddy gutters, evidently. Well, this whole social media thing allows you to avoid the business card ninja trick because all you have to do is just be a little bit ambient, a little bit present. I want to talk about what that actually entails because there's some level of you kind of going, he's funny, or funny looking, either one. And I'm willing to give this guy the benefit of the doubt, but I don't really know what this means. And all I'm hearing him say, he's revving us up to say, this is going to take a lot of time. Anyone get that little in the back of your head? You're like, this is a horrible thing. And then some of you have already thought, well, I already got this thing licked. My nephew does this. My daughter is doing this for my company, right? Every industry, this is totally true. People's nephews and daughters do it. Or unpaid interns. Oh my gosh, I was talking to a company. I won't name names, but they're one of their popular pens that they create rhymes with Schmarpy. And at the time, I gave them heck because they had two unpaid interns and a half-time employee managing this brand. And I said, how many millions of dollars does Flarpy pull in every year selling those pens? As quick body repair kits, by the way. How many of those do you pull in? How many millions of dollars do you pull in? It's not worth $80,000 to put this in the hands of somebody who's going to manage this brand, as opposed to two unpaid interns and a half-time employee? That's your face to the public world as a couple of people who are also wondering what they're going to do for their fantasy football league? God bless you. So I kind of accidentally shamed him like that on a stage, and so now they have employees, like two or three of them. This social media stuff does take time, but prospecting for buyers takes time. Am I wrong? Seeking good referrals takes time. Man, that's the one we're really twitchy about, isn't it? We want the referrals, don't we? Is there anyone in the room who's thinking, I'm all good. I don't need any more customers. Pshaw, send them somewhere else. Just checking. Because referrals is where you get most of your business. Am I wrong about that? I mean, I know a guy who does this thing. I know this guy. He's really fair. He's honest. Remember, the word honest was the number one thing they wanted. That's what I'm going to talk about, crap. The C in crap is for community. Community is a privilege. And when I say community, it is amazing how many people think they have a community. Certain soda pop companies think they have a community. These people are part of the Sprite community. Do you know what? Who thinks they're part of the Sprite community? I'm just checking. Because what do you do with that meeting? You think a Chamber of Commerce meeting is annoying? What do you do at a Sprite meeting? Hey, do you like Sprite? Yeah, me too. I drink Sprite Zero. Hey, me too. I mix vodka with mine. Yep. Okay, then. And then you walk. I don't even know what you do after that. Like, I don't know the next sentence in the Sprite community conversation. I am now in the Camaro community, which I've never been. Like, Saturn drivers, we kind of do this like, hey, isn't that cool? You have a Saturn. Mini Cooper people are, like, freakish about it. They have, like, little mini meetups and stuff. But Camaro guys have to do this cool thing. Like, we roll our window down. Like, I learned this. It was a new language for me. And you put your hand out kind of low, like a peace sign, but not exactly. As you go by. And there's a weird crossover, and I have no idea why, but Harley guys Not the CEO Harley guys, but the real ones with the beards and the wicked long ponytails. They do that to Camaros. Nice ride, that's what they say. Totally unrelated to my speech, I thought this car was going to be such a babe magnet. I was like, man, I'm getting this Camaro and chicks are going to talk to me like they've never talked to me before. I don't even have to be interesting. And I'm like, you know who loves my car? 13-year-old boys and 40-year-old dudes. And as they're stepping into their minivan, they're looking over at me like, how'd he get one of those? And I've learned I don't even know how to respond when somebody says, what a nice car, because it's not like I did it. Like, I didn't make it. I just bought it. So I have like a pat response because I'm embarrassed, and I say, thanks, it's the best stupid idea I ever had. And that's all I say. Okay, let's talk about crap. Community is a privilege. Being part of a community is the biggest goal. Being honored and allow people to consider that you're part of a community. So mostly we're talking location communities, right? We're talking about where you're from. Because not many people want to consider themselves part of the dent removal community, as it so happens. You do as colleagues, but of course you're not really giving each other a whole lot of business unless you have complementary businesses, and that's a whole other racket, and we won't talk about that. The opportunity is to be in the community where you are and to serve. I mean, Mike did it by doing a lot of different charities for kids and helping kids like Make-A-Wish and Little Smiles. Is that right? Little Smiles and all that. Charity is a great way to get people interested in what you're doing because then there's a cause element, a cause marketing element. And that's where the social media stuff is just super big and takes off a lot. There's charities like skip1.org. It's skip like skip something like skip a meal. number1.org, it's one of my favorites. Whereas you can go and you can put in like, say you thought you were gonna buy yourself a Louis Vuitton purse and you decide not to, and that's maybe $200. You can give the money to Skip One and they go out and they feed hungry people all over the place with it. But they do this on a social site that allows you that once you give that, you can push something that says, tell all my folks on Facebook they should give something too. That's the little magic in the old silk hat. That's what I'm talking when I think of referrals, is that little extra, just tell the folks on Facebook gets another few hundred people to look at that donation, and that's what we're looking for. That's the privilege of community that we have, is that we all come with communities now, right? You maybe don't think of yourself as a social media user, but if you call a bunch of people every week, you're a social media user. You're just using that 100-year-old one, and that's totally okay. 100 years ago, I'd be on the stage going, man, you've got to get phone. Phone is the coolest social thing I've ever seen in my life. I've got over 100 numbers I can call on phone. It is so cool. And you'd be like, oh, pshaw, people walk into my store and talk to me face to face. I kind of liked the point you were making earlier, Ron. You're saying, this is where you can go to shut your phones off and actually talk to the people in the same room as you. When did that become like a luxury? Right? But we do. We all carry our little office in our pocket. You know, I tell you, the minute you walk out that door to go pee, guaranteed, you're going to grab your phone and going to look down and you're going to go, oh. Because business does not stop at the conference anymore, does it? Right? You remember when kids used to like fall off the swing at school and you wouldn't know about it till they came home and had a red thing on their head? Now they text you right away. I mean, my school where my little 5-year-old is, I'm sure they take photos. Dude, look at Harold, he fell off the slide. You know, if there's not a bone protruding, it's okay with me. Holy cannoli. Kids are evidently made out of paper these days because, you know, we can't let them ride bikes anymore and all that. The other day I walked by my kid and he's in the house and he's doing this. He's a little bit autistic, so I'm thinking, well, okay, it's one of those autism things. I said, what are you doing? He goes, I'm hula hooping. I said, no, you're not. And I look on the screen and sure enough, he's hula hooping. His little wee guy's got like 8 hula hoops going and he's got like 2 on his head and 4 on his arm and 3 in his belly. And I'm like, wow, I bet you think you're doing something. Just making sure you're still with me. But this is the world we live in. That's really weird. Kids are fat. We can't let them go bicycle, but we can let them wobble in place in the living room. I wonder what that's about. The guy who made Doritos died, and it was front page news on 5 different newspapers. Oh crap, Doritos guy died. Now what are we gonna do? Who's gonna invent the bacon pizza combo cool ranch mash flavor that we need? I read a timeline of Doritos flavors the other day and I was just like, really? What are we doing? When the spaceship comes to take us. How do you populate community? What do you do? So I'm going to give you some real live examples. I sent out a tweet saying that I was going to go to Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And anyone from Milwaukee? I said, where's the best hamburger? No, I did not say that. I said, where does a guy go to eat in Milwaukee? And this guy, AJ Bombers, said, well, you can come to my restaurant. We make great hamburgers, and it's so much fun. We have, you know, peanuts get delivered to the table via a bomb. And they had me with the word bomb. I'm like, I'm in. I'll go. And so what they have there, no lie, is this like big metal thing, and they put peanuts in it, and it swoosh across the restaurant. It hits a target, and then the bomb bay doors open, and peanuts fall into a bucket. If you bring kids there, they're like, oh. And it's one of those places where you can drop your peanuts on the floor, and that's even crazier. So I was trying it with everything. Like, I was squirting ketchup on the floor, and the police came. It was really awkward. He has made his entire restaurant out of social media. This is a restaurant. He tweets people when they say anything about Milwaukee, but never in that kind of jerky, I'm ready to pounce on you way, just kind of like, hey, I'm having a great day in Milwaukee, wonder what I should do for lunch, and he'll say, hey, come by for a burger. In fact, I'll give you free fries or whatever you want. And he gets people in. He's been on the Food Channel now. He's been on something wars, Food Wars. I don't have TV, so to me, TV is always like this game that other people are making up to fool me. You know? Like, you'll tell me about some show, and I'll be like, no way. Somebody told me there's a show where they go to storage facilities that people haven't paid up on, and they argue over it. So I flew JetBlue from New York yesterday and watched a marathon of people auctioning off other people's crap. When the space aliens come, that's what they're going to be realizing about us, that we watch shows like this. Like, I hope another country invades us and we don't even know. I hope one day that we'll just be sitting there going, wow, look at that. I can't believe he bid $1,400 on that. And we'll be occupied by some other country. Ooh. What do you do? So you spend, you message, you use something like Facebook. There's over 800 million people on Facebook. One in 11 humans on the planet has a Facebook account. 750,000 new users a day. Most of them new people are females, most of them age 31 to 55. This is like the prime demographics of the universe, aren't they? The only trick is that they're looking to look at photos shared by their kids and their families and all that, so you gotta really work at getting them in there. But Facebook pages are starting to be a lot more beneficial for community building, not as advertising, but as a place where if you want to maintain a conversation with people, you might get a conversation going there that you don't normally get on your own site. What would you do? So the opportunity is to talk about things such as why to garage a car. That would have been a really good post for me to have read on a Facebook page before I left my car underneath 15 feet of snow and scratched the hood, thus needing some of your services after this speech. What else can you talk about? You could talk about things that people need to prepare for their insurance. There's all kinds of things you could do. Safe driving tips. That's what the auto insurance companies are all doing now. They've got all these websites about how to be safe drivers and all that. So I never tell them about tweeting and driving or anything, because you shouldn't do that. It turns out. That's why I bought a Camaro, by the way, because you can't possibly text, tweet, or do anything with your telephone while you're driving. You're just forever thinking you're going to hit something. So now I ask OnStar to tweet for me. Man, I wish they'd offered that. I would totally buy it. Can you tell Dave that his joke was funny? Just type LOL. Okay. Can you imagine being that operator? Oh my gosh. Sorry, I just had a horrible vision. I'm learning how to censor myself, everyone, and you're seeing it in real time. The community thing, the community opportunity is out in real life, too. The other thing you could do with these community things is, anybody throw events at their body shop or anything like that? Anybody allow humans in other than when they're getting their car fixed? All right. The winner of the presidential award of 2011, I might say, does. Anyone want to win that award from him next year? Take away his crown? Start throwing events at your facility. Hoteliers, the guest experience design kings, have people at their facility even when they're not making a dollar on it, because it gives them a warmth and a connection and a relationship. In Boston, Sullivan Tire, tire maintenance and oil changes and all that kind of stuff, goes to lots of social media events and like pays for the coffee or pays for the beer or throws events. I talk to Sullivan Tire on Twitter all the time about things not related to my tires, like the Red Sox or whatever. And he's part of that community. And I tell people in my community, if I lose a tire, if I have any kind of tire-related problem, that's where I'm going. I get my oil changes there because he's supporting us and paying into that community. It's reciprocal behavior. Humans are geared to do reciprocal behavior. Someone comes up to you after this and says, hey, I like your shirt. What do you say? You think of something to compliment them on. You sometimes have to dig a little deep, I know. But, you know, you're like, well, thanks, I like your ears. Not that I'm an ear collector. So Sullivan Tire earns it all the time by communicating. I'm using a social network, a brand new one called Google Plus. It just started in July. It's plus.google.com. It is really bleeding edge. But I'll tell you this, I found 5 different tire companies already on there, and I found 6 different repair shops on there before showing up here. Mind-boggling to me, because there's like 51 million users in the first few months of it being there. But here's what's different between this Google Plus and all these other ones. This is just a note for you. This is a little deeper level. Google is the number one search engine in the world. You all get that, right? So if someone doesn't know what they did, like car repair, Bedminster, New Jersey, or body shop in Clifton Heights, did I get it right? Oh my gosh, I'm doing great with memory today. We're in Orlando, aren't we? I heard 5 people say that. They Google for that, right? No one Bings, just FYI. Microsoft lost $5 billion trying to get people to think Bing was an awesome search engine. $5 billion in marketing budget. Your marketing budget, I know, is a little less. $5 million, I know, a year. We Google. So number one search engine in the world is Google. Anyone want to know the number 2 search engine in the world? YouTube. I heard it, by the way. These smart people right there. Or highly caffeinated. YouTube is the number 2 search engine in the world. Google Plus is the only social network that is fully indexed by Google right away. So as you're typing in things like car repair in Clifton Heights, it is sucking into the Google search fan and starting to get you a ranking that's highly different than the search engine optimization money that you paid for the last couple of years, because some guy came in and said, man, you need some SEO. And you were like, it's a 3-letter acronym, we must need it. And you know, I gotta tell you something, I know that what those people do is great, the search engine optimization people, I just don't understand it. It all seems like magic, and it just seems like I write a check. And they're like, okay, this'll fix you in the Googles. And then you're thinking, well, maybe someone will get some more business this way, right? And it never feels that way. You just feel like you spent money. And they say, but if you don't do this, you're going to be page 67 on car repairs in Clifton Heights, New Jersey, right? I mean, anywhere in that area, Pennsylvania. Google only indexes Google Plus. They don't index Twitter. They don't index Facebook. So if you decide you want a little bit more searchability, that's one thing to think about as you're planting your little community seeds. Now, which ones do you have to be on? Do you have to be on LinkedIn? Hint, no one asks their LinkedIn buddies where to get a dent pulled out. They ask for each other for jobs. Most people think that LinkedIn is just a referral network for jobs. And it's great. You could use it as a little digital resume if you want. It's a lot more powerful than that. Anybody like a power LinkedIn user in the room? Anyone consider themselves like a pretty active? There's a few people nodding their head. I mean, you're a little shy. I mean, I'm not crapping on LinkedIn. I'm just saying it's not exactly like, you know, it's not where you chit-chat. But we do chit-chat on Twitter. We chit-chat on Facebook. We talk on our blogs. If you guys want to learn how to listen using the technology of listening, just write down this phrase and go Google it a little later. It's grow bigger ears. I wrote you a free blog post, absolutely free, paid nothing for it. You get what you pay for. And it talks about different listening tools to hear what people are saying about your business, about your brand. It talks about the free tools, and it talks about some tools you could pay for. Not for me, I'm not selling a single thing, except for my charm. But these tools let you listen to see what people are talking about. Julian Smith, who wrote Trust Agents with me, has this ongoing joke about bloggers. People write blogs. Oh, you're a blogger? What do you complain about? You all get Google alerts on your phone? You know, that word's hard to say a lot of times in a row, isn't it? Do you all get Google alerts on your phone when you see it from some blog and you have no idea what that's, you know, does that person have 6 readers or 6,000 readers and what do I do about it? These search tools kind of help you with that a little bit. These listening tools, and that helps you with community. Back to CRAP, by the way. Remember, we have an acronym to fill out. The R in CRAP is referrals, and referrals are gold. If I told you nothing more than just go get the book The Referral Engine by John Jantz, I would pretty much have done my job, but I'll tell you a little bit more. A day in the life of a person with referrals is asking your customers, are they using things like Facebook and Twitter? They're putting little Facebook like buttons on your website, on your main website. This, by the way, is not high technology. You can get your web guy, who's also probably your nephew, to put in this button, and it's copy-paste. It's not anything tricky. If I can put it on my website and not break things, you can do it, I promise you. It's copy-paste level. Facebook like button, a Google plus one button, these kinds of things are people referring in the simplest and easiest of ways. I'll tell you a real life story about using the Facebook like button. Anybody hear of Zappos? They sell shoes is what most people think, but they sell bags and stuff like that. And I'm a certified collector, evidently, of man bags. You know, I need that perfect bag for my laptop, and then I'm like, well, but I just bought an iPad, so I need one that fits a laptop and an iPad, and then I get the one that's too big, and I realize I'm carrying too many things, so I need a small one. You know, it's man purses, you know? I was on Zappos, and I saw that they had little Facebook like buttons next to every single product on their site, every single thing, and I thought, well, this is kind of neat. It's like a little notepad. I'll just hit the like button on the ones I think are cool, and then I'll go back over to Facebook, and I'll kind of compare them all a little later. That was pretty neat. I'm over there hitting like, oh, that's a cool one. Yeah, I don't know, but I'll hit it. All of a sudden, I went back to my Facebook to see if this was taking, and there's comments piling up underneath the different bags I was looking at saying, that's not a really good-looking bag. That's kind of dorky-looking. Do you want to look like one of those computer dorks? I was accidentally shopping with 3,000 people who all had an opinion. Like, you know, that's what your significant other is for, is to malign you like that. But, you know, I had thousands of people telling me what kind of crappy bag choices I like, you know. And I ended up picking one they didn't like, so, you can look for referrals in other ways. You know, I mean, you don't just want to be the best person on Angie's list. You know, by the way, not everybody uses that thing. As much as they want to tell you that I found you off of Angie's list, you hear that maybe 1 in 70 times. You almost always ask the person, where'd you hear about me? And they always say, oh, I had a friend who said you worked on them and it came out okay. Seek those referrals. Don't, like, you know, jump on their leg or nothing like that, but you ask for those referrals. Say, you know, hey, if you're a Twitter user, this is our account. If you hate what we're doing, mention it. You know, mention our name in it and just say, hey, I really didn't like what you did. Solicit negative comments. I promise you this is the coolest opportunity you could ever have, because you can do something in public, in person, to fix those things where you couldn't before, and it was a lot of negative word of mouth. You all have those speeches, right? From years back when people would say, well, one person likes something, they'll tell 3 or 4 people, and then one person hates something, they'll tell 13 to 20 people. It's totally true, except now on the internet, you tell thousands of people at a swath, and Google sees it most of the time. And that ends up becoming a search result. Referrals are gold. So start seeking them. How else do you get referrals? You be where the people are. You go to where they are. The A in crap is for audience. And to me, the point is that audience is currency. When I say that, what I'm looking at is we're trying to cultivate visibility. How do you do that? So if you're doing paint, when you're covering really cool paint jobs you've done, shoot 2 minute or less YouTube videos. Grab your little flip video camera or grab your camera phone. Most everyone's phone in this audience has video on it now. You just haven't had any good reason to use it, unless you're a state senator. Another, ooh, I didn't do it. You'll find absolutely zero naked pictures of me or anybody I know on my phone. Not true. Just realized it. Very tastefully done, though. Audience is currency. When you get people to actually pay attention and care, and when you don't jump up and down and go, look at me, body shop, you know, or parts guy, or whatever you want to be, but you get them to care what you're talking about because you're talking about what they're into, this is currency, because then suddenly when you need something or you ask for something, they take advantage of it. Who's doing email marketing right now? Oh my gosh, I wanted to see every hand come up. Okay, so email's not dead. I'll tell you two things really quickly. One is all statistics, about 55.79% of all statistics are made up. Okay, in a survey that Citi did, just checking to make sure you're still with me, kids, I am between you and this floor opening, and we've got like 7 minutes to get our business done. And I got to get you the pee and crap, but I will. I will never say that sentence aloud like that ever again. I hope there's not one of those speaker rating things. speaker made a lot of potty humor. Oh my gosh, I totally derailed myself. Audience. So my thought is basically that what you're trying to do with audiences is you're trying to tell interesting stories to them about them. The most interesting thing people want to see is about themselves. Go on to YouTube and find interesting YouTube videos, not even about your stuff, but about things that might be interesting to the people who are enthusiasts and customers you want to care about. Or, here's one, remember referrals? Shoot video testimonials of them if they're willing. Can you give me a quick 2-minute testimonial? It's 2 minutes of your time. I just want to put it up on my website. Is that okay? Don't get crazy. Don't get all legal about this and need a bunch of release forms and crap like that. Just say, I want to just put it up on YouTube if you're willing. You can even say what you want. You can say if you don't like it. Again, I will give money to the person who is daring enough to put negative comments up on their site. Oh, stats. That's what I was going to tell you, because here's another stat. When people look at sites that have referrals all over them and they see nothing but positive referrals, 70% of people report that there's something wrong with the website. They just don't know what it is. There's something wrong about the data that they're looking at and they can't put their finger on it. Some smaller percentage say there's only positive referrals. But the minute you see only positive referrals, you smell a trap. That's an Admiral Akbar from Star Wars reference. Totally true. So stats, email marketing. In email marketing, Citigroup did a survey where people were asked the question of daily relationships with brands. People ages 18 or older, if they had a daily relationship with a brand. Here's what they said. 18 or older, 4% of people wanted to have a daily relationship with a brand on Twitter. 11% of people wanted a daily relationship with a brand on Facebook. 93% of people opted for that daily relationship to be an email. Email is not dead. Email is still the bearer network of all this social media stuff. Your email marketing has to change, though. First off, if your email is coming from someone that says the email address is from do not reply at pleasegoddon'twritebacktome.com, you are not seeking a relationship with the person on the other end of that email. FYI. Turns out you should probably make it at some kind of name that maybe isn't even sales at suchandsuchparts.com. You could even put a fake name. I don't care. Put Dave. Man, everyone's going to think they have a great relationship with Dave. I don't care. Just make it a little more human. That's what I'm asking. The other thing is, if you are designing it with all kinds of great HTML so it looks like an amazing web page, hint, does anybody in this room have a 23-inch monitor sitting beside them, besides the boys in the back? Anybody? I'm just checking. Desktops, you got a Dell Latitude or an Inspiron or something right beside you? Nope. We all have 3-inch screens, right? Some of us have iPads, which, by the way, you're my people. I'm amongst friends. You're designing for this now. CrackBerry users, unfortunately? Sorry? Anybody? Okay. Sorry. Have you ever seen the internet through a CrackBerry? It looks like this. Dear colleague, you are so important to us, I'm going to... because it has no idea what you're saying with that HTML baloney. Make the emails brief. Does anyone really want to read a 1,400-word missive about all the incredible things that you have to sell them? Absolutely not. They want 250 or less words. I'm so sorry. I know we think that the country is dumbing down. That's not true. That's just stupider people who say that. Telling you, I'm doing this all the way to the end. They want brief emails. They want emails with one request at a time, one thing at a time. And by the way, if you're emailing everything to everybody, that just means you're a lazy marketer. And I know you don't have time to market as it is, but find someone to fix your database and parse it up just a little bit so you can email to people who need this versus people who need that, because then it feels more relevant and then they open it more. What you're looking for is a great open rate and a great click rate, right? This is email marketing. Do it. It is so amazing how email marketing is the secret sauce in the social media world, because a tweet going by in a stream you might miss, but the chance to get something in the inbox that actually someone wants to do something with, that's good. By the way, it is not like come in for, you know, buff out your dent Friday. Although, I kind of thought about that last night. I was thinking that might not be a bad gig, right? You know, Friday's kind of a slow day. No one wants to be there anyway. Just get a bunch of those long old-timey dents out of the way. Come by for a special. The P is about passion. If there's one thing I hope I've sold you on, that this is a passion required kind of game. If you are going to get into this social media stuff, please do not just check a box. Please do not say, yes, I've got the Twitters, and have that stupid, I didn't even put up a face on it account. By the way, if your logo on your Twitter account is not your face and it's a logo, I will give you a little hint about humanity. Ever since birth, we are trained to look for heads. We are trained to look for faces and eyes. It is an absolutely biological thing, because we're looking for eyes because we know the milk is about there. All humans are born with this. That is why we see faces when we look at buildings. That's why we see car grills as faces, right? It's built into our psyche. So every time you have a chance to put up an avatar and you put your logo, I have never once had a conversation with a logo at a conference, except for that one time, and I was a little bit drunk, and I thought they seemed like a nice person. P is for passion. Please be passionate about doing this. When we go out to the show floor, which is in 1 1/3 minutes, be passionate about the people you meet there. Don't phone it in. This is our great opportunity to network and meet each other. That's the same thing you're going to do in these social networks. The day in the life of a social network user, it's not a whole lot of time. It's a lot of little tiny ambient times. It's sending out a message. It's responding to their stuff. It's commenting back to their stuff. It's two-way conversations instead of ads. If you had the choice between an ad and a conversation to sell what you're selling, what do you take? You pick the conversation every time, right? Ads are really good air support for really deep ground troop activity. Do I have any other things I need to tell you? Oh, the other thing I use social media for a lot is for pre-event and after sales. Pre-event, coming here, I started looking at who's talking on Twitter using NACE or ASRW, which I kept calling ASWR. I looked at who was talking about cars, bad one, because everyone's talking about cars. They just mean those things you drive or Lightning McQueen. And by the way, cars in Orlando, still Lightning McQueen. That was awkward. But you could start searching things. I always look around for information in the venue. I start looking at who's talking about the hotel I'm in. Because on the odd shot that there's some business executive I want to land, that's what I want to find out. I want to see that serendipitous opportunity to catch somebody being somewhere where I am. These tools like Foursquare, which I barely like to talk about, these are those location tools that let you check in at physical locales. I think of them as stalker devices. I'm not into it. Sorry, I hate to be like not so social media, but that one's twitchy to me. But I will say this, if you start using those tools for your remote mobile marketing, cool things happen. If anyone's thinking about getting into remote mobile marketing, I don't know a thing about it. I will tell you to go to a site called 44, like the number 44, doors.com. It's my friend Tim Hayden, and he's doing cool, interesting stuff with it. Time management is the last thing written on the slide. It is time to get out of this room. My name is Chris Brogan. If you want to learn anything about me, just Google the word Chris Brogan. You'll find me. Drop me a line. Send me some kind of a feedback or whatever, or say hi to me. I'll be at the DuPont booth at I don't remember a clock and at the MSOLRP thing soon. And I'm so grateful for your time. Please have a good rest of your conference.